Boa tarde.
Olá, olá a todos. Muito obrigada pela vossa presença. Hoje, na primeira parte da nossa conferência, vamos fazer as apresentações em inglês, visto termos convidados internacionais. Hello, it is my great pleasure to welcome you all to our conference. Today, we will talk about global opportunities in environmental engineering and listen to some grand influencers that inspire us. Our first guest speaker is Pratap Raju. Pratap, which will talk about opportunities in climate tech growing in the world, has been in the climate and clean tech space for a number of years. Founding partner of the Climate Collective Network, which is building out the climate and clean tech ecosystems in South Asia. A graduate from Harvard and then Oxford University, Pratap has been an entrepreneur for the past 20 years in IT, media, renewable energy, and now climate. Pratap, thank you so much for joining us.
All right, thank you. Thank you for inviting me. This is quite exciting. I'm actually moved to Goa 3 months ago, so I know there's a
Oh, that's
connection to
excellent.
Portugal from Goa.
Wow.
So, boa tarde.
Boa tarde. The floor is yours, Pratap.
Great. So I'm going to just share with you my experience in climate tech, but more importantly, how the world is changing for potential entrepreneurs or innovators in climate tech. I have a small presentation. Let me just share my screen. Great, if you could see the screen. This is actually an interactive deck, but we don't have time. I just have like 7, 8 minutes. So I run startup accelerators, you know, startups who are just entering the market or raising funds in the climate tech space. I work primarily with the Climate Kick European Union program, which supports climate innovation for the last 10 years in Europe. I'm a global trainer here for India, Africa, and Southeast Asia. And I run other programs with other partners in supporting startups. So we've done about 400 startups over the last 3 years. So I just wanted to now share some very fascinating data for those exploring climate tech. I won't go to the technical side, but more the kind of what's changed over the last 5 years. Climate change, of course, is a very important issue. There's a lot of, it's been important for many decades since the late 80s when public consciousness has increased. The fight is still on, right? Sometimes we're pessimistic. Sometimes it's overwhelming. Every day there's news about a hurricane or changes in weather, flooding that is unusual, temperature, heat waves. But I go by this philosophy. It's a fourth century church leader, St. Augustine. Nothing great has ever been achieved without hope. Now, we need to get to net zero emissions, meaning carbon dioxide or greenhouse gases generally, to as soon as possible. What do we need for this? We need more money, right? We need stronger leaders, political leaders, family leaders, religious leaders, all leaders, policy, but we also need more innovation. So why do we need innovation? I'm a solar developer, solar wind developer. I've developed and commissioned 84 megawatts of power plants since 2009. And if you ask me, is solar going to win versus coal or renewables versus coal, the answer is we've already won, right? The vast majority of new power plants in the US the last 10 years is solar and wind renewables. The vast majority in India is solar and wind as well. So why do we need innovation? Well, one example I think engineers would appreciate this is we have to solve for other issues. Solar and wind have intermittent, meaning the power, the supply is up and down depending on the clouds or the wind. How do you inject that into the grid? We need more technologies. We need energy storage solutions. We need forecasting solutions. How do you tell the grid operator 24 hours in advance how much power you can supply 24 hours in advance? we need more robotic solutions. Where solar becomes more prevalent and larger, wider deployed, water will become an issue. How do you clean those power plants, the panels, with less water? That requires innovation. Here is a great slide from IEA, International Energy Agency. If we were to reach net zero emissions by 2070, you can see here mature technologies, solar, wind, and other existing technologies. Adoption means they've already been developed, but they're looking to get to the market. A significant amount of innovation has yet to be designed, maybe 30, 40%. We need to go faster. We need to get to net zero emissions maybe by 2050. And an even bigger amount of innovation does not exist. And this is the opportunity in today's world. But why startups? I mean, couldn't governments do this? Couldn't large corporations, Schneider Electric, Siemens, big engineering giants handle this? What I've learned oftentimes with innovation is a lot of innovation takes risk. And if you're working for a large company, it's very hard to take that risk. Entrepreneurs can take that risk. It's very hard if you're an executive in a big group and risking on something new. I want to share with you something very fascinating here. For those who are familiar with startups now, the last 20 years, we've seen big startups like Facebook, Google, Airbnb, et cetera. Are there climate tech startups, right, in climate? And these are in the last, you know, say 8 years. I'll show you the answer. There, as of last year, right before COVID, there were 43 startup unicorns. Unicorn means $1 billion valuation for a startup. That's not the only thing. There's many ways to be successful in startups without being a unicorn, but it suggests something is changing. So what are some of these unicorns, right? As if you can name, I can't see the chat box here, but that's okay. What are some of these big climate tech startups? We all know one, recent startups. We all know one for sure, right? It started also, it's somewhat like a garage 15 years ago, Tesla, right? EVs back then made no sense. This is, you know, in the middle of the last decade. Who would believe electric vehicles would be really on the roads today? Now, Goldman Sachs came up with a report saying, I think 25% of all new future vehicles in 2025 will be EVs. That's amazing. That's how fast the transformation is happening today. We have other areas across climate tech, whether in food, Beyond Burger, plant-based burgers that McDonald's carries, Nest. This is the one that Google bought. It's those smart thermometers that help you control devices in the home, connect to the, for example, the distribution utility, electric utility, and these are coming out. I want to share something else for those who are exploring entrepreneurship. When I started in entrepreneurship in clean tech, there was no money. And that was for a strange reason. 12, 14 years ago, the majority of venture capital went to climate tech or clean tech. Then it went bust, 2008, 9, 10. And it was a dry period. In 2013, 7 years ago only, globally, only $400 million went into all climate tech startups. That's not much. Today, last year, $16 billion. Now, what's this answer? $16 billion went into to climate tech startups, and this number is growing. It's 6% of all global venture capital funds. What that tells me is, one, the trajectory is zooming up, just as the opportunities are zooming up in climate, as public consciousness of sustainability increases amongst corporates, governments, even consumers. So this is exciting time. I'm gonna end with just a few. I know that this is really heavy weighted towards funding, but it does signal opportunity. Many corporates are now looking to support climate tech. For example, Amazon has a $2 billion climate fund. They just made their announcements, I think today or yesterday, first recipients. Microsoft has a $1 billion climate fund looking for big breakthroughs in energy, I think, if I'm not mistaken. Unilever has a $1 billion global fund for climate tech, perhaps focused on their internal operations, which is around plastics, plastic waste, efficiency in their supply chain. And this is just the sampling, and this is just the momentum is continuing to increase. I'm going to end with a small quote, and this is I grew up in the U.S., so this is Abraham Lincoln, 16th president of the U.S., the best way to predict the future is to create it. So this is just a few examples of how the world is changing. And when I started 6 years ago, I want to do a startup to support the environment was something NGOs did. But it was not for serious business. There are too many opportunities. Today's world is kind of starting to turn upside down, where in fact we can support the environment, run or found new companies, right? And this requires innovation. I think, especially if in this group of engineers, there is a lot of applied engineering in particular needed. Climate and environment problems are everywhere I work from. Of course, India, a big country, to even small countries like Maldives. I don't know if you know Maldives, but it's 400,000 people on the smallest of islands. Where do they put their trash? They actually literally have an island right next to the main island, Malé, which I think they call it the trash island, where they have to burn it. So we need solutions everywhere, and we need everyone to pitch in, and the support is increasing. That's my little kind of a presentation on opportunities for climate, especially for entrepreneurs.
And thanks for that. Was excellent. Congratulations. Thanks for sharing this experience with us. I would like now to introduce Shanti Karanjit, Chief Technical Advisor at the United Nations Development Programme and with academic background in various environmental disciplines, which includes environmental management from Yale University. Shanti will be talking about shouldering the responsibility of building better, stronger, and greener. Shanti, we are so honored to have you here. Thank you so much for providing us with this experience. It is a pleasure to hand over to you.
Thank you so much, Maria, and good evening, because it is 8:45 in the evening for us here. Talking from a small country in Horn of Africa called Djibouti, and let me try to put some non-engineering, non-tech heavy, speech for you, my objective of today's intervention is actually to trigger some thoughts, make you do come and do your part, So let me just start with thanking Pratap, for laying the ground, and then that's a nice segue for me to speak a few words here. So as Maria mentioned, I want to talk about shouldering the responsibility of building better, stronger, and greener. Why I say this, and I have objective, because I want to really make all of us realize that all of us have a part in how we want the last sentence that Pratap said. So let me start with just a few questions. What comes to your mind when you think of development? And what are the first images that cross your mind when you hear the words like development or infrastructure, climate risk, disaster, resilience, all these buzzwords that kind of like flood our news and the social media, and then like mark yourself safe in Facebook, all those kind of things. What comes into your mind? I think there can't be like one word or one image that will cross your mind, because this is so much that, in flash of a second that will come into your thoughts. Some of this will be because you've experienced those. Somebody wants to join me. and also maybe through the secondhand experience from your friends, relatives, or something that you have seen in the social media or, you know, like a mass media. And depending upon what you've seen or experienced, you know, like, and something that has grasped your attention, the nature, the scale, and the impact of each of these elements will have a wide spectrum of, you know, like, impact on you. Yes, I will also want to say that we are living in a world with bountiful opportunities, but at the same time, we are facing the challenges to a large extent, I must say, something that we have invited upon ourselves. Yes, you might also be saying, like, then why are we talking about this? This is for, you know, there are like UN conventions, there are like commitments, obligations that every country have, you know, like signed up for. So it is then whose responsibility is this if it is, you know, like there are conventions and then obligations. So is it for the like organizations like UN that I work for, or for governments, or for the academia, or for public sector, private sector? Or like research entities, whose is this? Like yours, mine, somebody else's? And I think, you know, like many people will have like different opinions. I don't want to like start defending, you know, like each one of them. But I think for me, the correct answer, you know, would be all of the above. The way, you know, like when we are doing that as engineers, maybe you have also faced some of the tests where you have multiple choice questions. And then you have to answer, you know, like all the choices sound. Every person or every entity, every organization, small or big, have a role to play. They have like, because there are a wide range of interventions that has to be, that can be done or has to be done. Let me now just talk about some data, you know, like maybe some of these sound familiar, some of these might be like, oh, I didn't know this will be so big, or, you know, like the statistics sound something wrong. So let me just start with the number of people who were either become, you know, like all like climate refugees or climate migrants. In 2017 alone, there were about 18.8 million people who were internally displaced just because of the climate induced disasters. And let us take up like the two decades, you know, like and between 1998 to 2017, and just look at the climate induced, you know, like disasters impacting the lives and the, you know, like the losses in that sense. So it has killed about 1.3 million people in just two decades, just because of climate disasters, and about 4.4 billion people were either left homeless or injured, or, you know, like they were displaced, or like they needed some emergency assistance. Out of this, about 91%, you know, like were affected by floods, and out of like storms or droughts, all of these can be associated with the climate change and the climate related impacts. And out of these again, you know, like I'm kind of like trying to zero it down further and further, floods. Floods have, you know, like claimed about 50% of the affected people all over the world. But it is not just about the heart-wrenching, you know, like lives lost, or, you know, like this many people were left homeless. But there's also a price tag, economic loss. So economic loss is about, like in this time period, it was about $3 trillion that were lost in terms of money, you know, like because of different damages that have happened because of these disasters. So in just 2019 alone, the year that just passed, and like for 2020, we are yet to, you know, like hear the results, you know, like of, because of COVID pandemic, the results will be like at different level. But like just the year that we, you know, like said goodbye and then like came into this new world of like pandemic world. So in 2019 alone, we saw 409 different natural disasters and out of and caused over $232 billion worth of loss. So what I'm driving to, you know, like all this data, all this, you know, like talk what I'm trying to say. I'm trying to say is that, yes, climate-related disasters are like heart-wrenching because people have lost their lives or like homes, but also it is economically dragging down spiral kind of affair. But nothing is lost, you know, like because there is a good news as it is. And as for engineers, this is appeal to all of you listening today. You know, like, or will be listening later on the recording, is appeal that there is, you know, like significant amount of damage control that can be done if only through your skills, that the power that you have with your academic skills and the knowledge, that you will be able to save the lives and the economic losses that can be significantly reduced by proper planning or programming, or you know, like just adding the climate resilience as part of the equation of your formula when you will be doing your calculations, your projections. So let's say, for instance, you are trying to design a bridge or a building or even a solar power plant or something like that. So just if you are not taking it as business as usual, or not just this development as a development activity alone, but look it through the climate resilience aspect. And like you must have heard about the climate proofing element. If you just look at that and just put the climate resilience into the entire formula, the whole thing will look different. And it is not just, you know, like the aspect from like, okay, do good, feel good aspect, but there is actually an investment aspect to it as well. There's not a joke that why there are so many in a private sector putting their money or investing in the climate bonds or green bonds, you know, like climate insurances, all of that, because there is definitely the business case as well. You know, like maybe this kind of link up to what Pratap was showing earlier with the climate tech, interventions. So that is the linkage, you know, like it is not just the technology on its own, but this has a better, greater good to serve for, for humanitarian aspects as well. And it is not, I think this is the buzzwords that you hear about decarbonization, climate resilience, climate security. They all sound fancy. I don't think it is just for development workers like myself, but some, practical, technical experts like engineers like you yourself, also to have your bit and also look at it from your angle, because these are the clear indicators of where the new development paradigm should go towards. You know, like it is about being carbon conscious consumer, or having, playing your role in making the development interventions more like greener or like more climate resilient by making them climate proof. So I don't think, designing a building which is climate resilient infrastructure is an option anymore, shouldn't be taken as an option, but something as a must do aspect. And, a label of a carbon consumer shouldn't be something like fancy, another feather in the hat, but something that has to be part of your lifestyle. So I just want to give an example of what has happened just recently in Djibouti. It was last year this time, it was just 300 millimeters of rain over 3 days or 2.5 days, something like that. Just like, mind you, so 300 millimeters of rain. And you know what was the loss? There were over 2,000 people lost their lives. And then the economic loss of this 300 millimeters of rain was more than $40 million of economic loss, because the infrastructure was damaged, across all sectors, like health sectors, education sector, all the other infrastructures, public sector, and like everything. If you count, it was more than 40 million in loss. And if you just count something for 300 millimeters of rain, and if you look at it, when we were digging back, what was the cause? Because the drainage system was not designed properly. Something rings the bell for you, there's something that you in your maybe in your coursework and later on when you will be in the practical field, something for you to, I think, for all of you to think about how, you can do your part from your level and then contribute towards making the whole world like safer, greener, and building better. And I think we cannot afford to now at this time of the development pathway, we cannot think about, we can just do away with business as usual construction or business as usual aspect of energy supply or generation. And especially it is so because in the case of low income countries, whatever small amount they have for development, they cannot be wasting again and again for the same work. For instance, the 2019 November rain, the flood that happened here. So the government had to make a tough decision whether to move forward, build something new, or go back and take several steps back and repair the damage, like take care of the damage that have happened. Of course, government had to take steps back and take the money that was planned for other development activities and move back to repair whatever was already done. So it is actually going the spiral and then losing all the gains that have been hard on through the development interventions. So in my point of view, you know, like there is like the need to look at all the aspects from the different paradigm. And this is something that, you know, like is not just academic or not just for the articles or not just for the lessons learned to be, you know, like confined to that, but something that can be brought to the practical level. And then as a development intervention, like our practitioners, we want to actually implement all of that and then like and do our part as best as possible. But it is also for other sectors and for everybody else to do your part. And that is, I think, shouldering the responsibility together so that we pass on the world, you know, like just not just for future generation. There is like rhetoric about, okay, we pass on the world for future generation. But I think for the parents also, from the parents, for the parents' generation also, from whom we took the world and giving them their last years, like few years that they are living in the world that is not that they can want to recognize. So I think that is how we have to take the fancy words and the commitments of the governments and all of that into our own shoes and then take it as our own responsibility as well. And do our part from whichever academic professional background we have so that we can all shoulder the responsibility together and live a better world. Thank you so much. And I hope that at the end of this, you will have some triggering thoughts or some like contradicting thoughts saying like, oh, what is she talking about? It doesn't make sense, you know, like kind of thing. It is good to have it in the speech, but not practical in the real life. You might have all those kind of like thoughts going through your mind, but all those I think are valid. It is just the point of view and perspective that has to be, you know, like a little bit more wider and open, and everything will be visible for everybody. Thank you so much.
Shanti, that was truly inspiring. Thank you so much for your time and for sharing those ideas with us. A nossa próxima convidada é Catarina Pinto, engenheira do ambiente formada pela Faculdade de Engenharia da Universidade do Porto e com mestrado em Engenharia de Segurança e Higiene Ocupacional pela mesma instituição. A Catarina é atualmente engenheira do processo na Glen Aqua, na Irlanda, empresa do grupo Mottingill, e vem também partilhar connosco a sua experiência no mercado de trabalho. Catarina, muito obrigada por ter aceito o convite. Imagino que esteja a viver uma experiência inesquecível. Eu própria estive em Viena, na Áustria e posteriormente em Inglaterra, neste último a trabalhar na Unilever Corporate, e enriqueci muito, quer a nível pessoal, quer a nível profissional. Fale-nos então daquilo que tem sido a sua experiência fora de portas.
Olá, boa tarde a todos. Agradeço já o convite pela ordem a este fantástico evento. Esta minha experiência tem sido bastante enriquecedora. Neste momento, aliás, nos últimos meses, com esta situação do Covid, surgiu uma oportunidade de ir para a Inglaterra, neste momento trabalhar em Londres. E vou só pôr aqui uma apresentaçãozinha para auxiliar. Não sei se toda a gente consegue ver o meu ecrã. Espero que sim.
Estamos a ver.
Sim, pronto. Portanto, todo o meu percurso começou, eu queria já referir, porque não sei se são muitos elementos estudantes ou não neste evento, mas queria já dar o conselho que durante o percurso de universidade se envolverem em organizações, eu procurarem ter uma experiência que possam vender aos vossos empregadores no futuro, porque todas as experiências que vocês possam ter vão ser benéficas, se vocês conseguirem adquirir capacidades que vão ser-vos úteis no vosso trabalho. Também tive a oportunidade de trabalhar na Ordem dos Engenheiros, no setor de qualidade e no processo de auditoria, e tive na organização do primeiro engenho, que também obtive bastantes capacidades e soft skills que no meu dia-a-dia acabo por utilizar. Entretanto, entrei na Glen Aqua, através do programa de trainees da Mottingill, e fui colocada no mercado da Irlanda e do Reino Unido, tendo feito o meu percurso como engenheira de projeto, estando a trabalhar desde, dependendo dos projetos envolvidos, em diferentes áreas, dependendo de, na área de processo, na parte de desinfecção de uma ETA, à parte de projeção e planeamento de trabalhos em obra, e a próprios testes e operações criação das ETAs para entrega ao cliente. Quando a Água é uma empresa muito forte no setor ambiental, no tratamento de águas residuais e de águas para abastecimento, e tem vindo a crescer imenso e, entretanto, tive a oportunidade de vir para a Inglaterra, que tem sido uma experiência incrível. A dimensão de trabalho é completamente diferente daquilo que eu estava habituada na Irlanda, o que acaba por trazer uma realidade que é, também acabamos por passar para em Portugal, que é em diferentes ambientes de trabalho, em diferentes culturas, diferentes empresas, temos que nos saber adaptar, principalmente quando estamos em diferentes países. Temos o extra de novas legislações, novas especificidades de guidelines e tudo, que devemos acompanhar para saber se tudo aquilo que estamos a instalar é compliant com aquilo que está estabelecido nas legislações. E eu neste momento estou no Reino Unido e estou numa fase de projeto que é muito intensa, visto que temos uma entrega de água em rede no dia 26 de dezembro e estamos naquela fase de instalação e de início de comissionamento em que temos tudo a funcionar e uma data a cumprir e que temos que ter os planos de diferentes equipas bastante bem organizados, porque neste momento temos equipas de instalações elétricas, instalações mecânicas, temos a equipa de processo que nos acompanha a verificar se todas as instalações estão a ser seguidas como pelo design, temos revisões constantes e inspeções pelo cliente, e uma parte de segurança em obra é algo que tem um grande impacto, porque de um momento para o outro, como em Portugal, podem-nos parar a obra, mas a data de entrega de água em rede continua a mesma. E se algo acontece, pode-nos causar um atraso de 2 ou 3 dias, que no, em termos de encadeamento de trabalhos vai ter uma consequência temporal muito maior. E uma coisa que é muito benéfica no nosso curso de engenharia é que nos deixa com bastante traquejo para nos adaptarmos a diferentes ambientes. Uma das coisas que aprendi quando cheguei aqui foi que o curso de ambiente é bastante reconhecido aqui, porque nós, para além de competências técnicas de processo, também sabemos a parte da engenharia de sermos práticos e saber adaptar-nos a diferentes diversidades, o que é bastante benéfico. Gostaria de desmitificar algumas coisas que aprendi quando cheguei cá, como já referi, de ser flexível à cultura para nós vamos. E outra coisa que estamos vindo a perceber agora com o Covid também é que o que nós queremos fazer agora pode mudar de um momento para o outro, porque o mercado de trabalho muda. Estava a trabalhar num projeto na Irlanda e de um momento para o outro, como as obras fecharam na Irlanda durante tempo indeterminado, colocaram-me em Inglaterra. E nós temos capacidade para enfrentar esses desafios e acreditar que tudo que ambicionamos, se nós temos um objetivo, iremos lá chegar. Podemos saltar de áreas diferentes, especialmente no curso de ambiente, que é tão diverso. Podemos trabalhar em águas, podemos trabalhar na área de resíduos, e não tem mal saltar de área em área se estamos a sentir-nos realizados. Não sei se alguém tem alguma questão. Tenho medo de passar no tempo.
Olá, Catarina, novamente, se calhar tirava a apresentação, por favor. Muito obrigada por nos trazer essa boa energia e experiência, foi um privilégio ouvi-la. Força e muito sucesso para o seu futuro.
Muito obrigada.
Last but not least, temos agora a nossa querida Daniela Amorim, formada pela Universidade de Aveiro, vencedora do Prémio Melhor Estágio em Ambiente da Ordem dos Engenheiros Região Norte. 2019. Daniela, já sabemos que nos vai querer falar como um engenheiro do ambiente pode ser parecido como uma borboleta e fazer engenharia. Estamos super curiosos. Força!
Olá a todos, obrigada pelo convite. Mais uma vez, é um privilégio estar a falar para todos, principalmente se no meio de nós temos jovens engenheiros, porque isso faz-me lembrar há 2 anos atrás, quando eu terminei o meu mestrado integrado na Universidade de Aveiro e fiquei a entrar no mercado de trabalho com aquelas confusões todas que nós temos na nossa cabeça naquele momento. E sim, eu vou compartilhar a minha tela, porque eu sempre fui uma pessoa muito... muito prática, e sendo eu uma pessoa muito prática, decidi que seria interessante ter uma apresentação muito, muito fora do normal, mas muito dentro do normal, que é a engenharia, que é inovar. E então, eu acho que estão a ver a minha tela? Acho que sim. Eu vou, o meu objetivo é, nos 5 minutos que tenho, comparar uma borboleta com um engenheiro do ambiente. Ou seja, porquê que eu estou a fazer isto? Para me apresentar assim em 2 minutinhos só de enquadramento. Eu comecei o meu percurso académico na FIOP, como engenheira informática. Tenho esse curso ainda muito presente em mim, contudo achei que era um curso muito fechado para aquilo que eu estava à espera, e então decidi abrir horizontes e então fui para a engenharia do ambiente. E daí eu usar a borboleta, porque eu sou uma pessoa que ao longo do meu percurso académico fui passando por diversas etapas e passei alguns anos já por algumas experiências. Se nós olharmos para uma borboleta, todos nós sabemos que ela inicia a partir de um ovo, depois vem a larva consegue se transformar numa pupa e da pupa sai a borboleta que toda a gente gosta. Se nós olharmos para um estudante, nós podemos pensar num estudante naquela fase em que nós estamos a escolher o curso, ou seja, quando nós escolhemos o curso é aquele momento em que está a nascer a ideia em nós, é aquele momento em que nós estamos a fervilhar de vontade de ir aprender alguma coisa nova. E depois chega aquela fase onde nós andamos na universidade, e o conselho que eu dou a todos é aproveitem esta fase, porque é na universidade que nós temos tudo, ou seja, é na universidade que nós temos as melhores pessoas para nos ensinarem tudo aquilo que elas têm. E se nós pensarmos na fase de transformação, a minha aconteceu, e daquilo que eu vejo pelos meus colegas também, no momento em que nós fazemos a nossa tese ou o nosso estágio. Isto porquê? A engenharia do ambiente permite-nos ser mil e uma coisas. Nós podemos trabalhar nos mais diversos ramos, seja nos resíduos, seja na água, seja no ar, seja no que for. Eu fui para um ramo que não é muito normal, pelo menos não era muito normal, na Universidade de Aveiro serem pessoas, que era o ramo da certificação ambiental e da sustentabilidade e da gestão. Isto porquê? Porque eu acho que se nós quisermos mesmo fazer a diferença e melhorar tudo o que é o nosso planeta, nós temos que começar por melhorar as empresas. E então eu achei que a gestão ambiental seria o início do meu caminho, e foi aí que eu fiz a transformação. E depois, quando pensamos numa borboleta, podemos pensar em nós enquanto engenheiros, porque nós enquanto engenheiros temos que ter a capacidade de nos adaptar a qualquer questão, como ainda agora a Catarina estava a falar. E depois temos uma vantagem muito grande, é que nós engenheiros do ambiente conseguimos ser o elo de comunicação entre todas as engenharias. A minha acontece-me com muita frequência eu estar em reuniões onde tenho, imaginem, um engenheiro civil e do outro lado um engenheiro físico. E no meio da conversa eu consigo fazer a ponte entre um e o outro, porque a nossa engenharia permite isso mesmo. O nosso ramo permite-nos conseguirmos tocar um bocadinho em todas as engenharias, de forma a conseguirmos unir e conseguirmos progredir nos trabalhos. Antes de vos falar daquilo que é a minha borboleta, eu falo-vos um bocadinho da minha experiência. Eu efetivamente terminei o mestrado com o objetivo de sistemas de gestão e fiz o estágio da Ordem, o que foi o vencedor do prémio na área dos sistemas de gestão, muito focada no que é gestão ambiental e na gestão da qualidade. Mas não ficámos apenas por aquilo que nós conhecemos apenas das ISOs. Eu acho que nós temos que ter a capacidade de inovar e de melhorar aquilo que estamos passando. E então eu tenho uma componente aqui ao lado, que é a área da sustentabilidade. Ou seja, a partir da gestão ambiental, eu acho que nós conseguimos chegar à sustentabilidade. E é este trabalho que eu tenho vindo a fazer nas empresas por onde vou passando, de forma a complementar um pouquinho as tarefas que já estão implementadas, os procedimentos e tudo mais. E uma das coisas que me ajudou muito aqui no meio foi ter feito o curso de auditor coordenador da ISO de 14001 e da 9001, por um motivo. Quando nós somos auditores, conseguimos ver as empresas de uma forma tipo macro, ou seja, conseguimos nos desviar e olhar para elas e perceber de que forma é que podemos pôr aqueles mecanismos todos a funcionar de uma forma melhor para o nosso planeta e também para as nossas pessoas e para a nossa economia. Afinal, é isso que é a sustentabilidade. Olhando agora sim para a minha borboleta, o que é que eu coloquei na minha bagagem ao longo do passar do tempo enquanto estava na formação académica? Eu aprendi sobre gestão, ou seja, como é que nós podemos planear e modelar os cenários que vão acontecer. Temos inúmeras cadeiras no curso de engenharia que nos permite aprender esta área, basta que a gente tenha o foco devido e consigamos desviar aquela aprendizagem para a área ambiental. A resiliência é outro patamar, eu acho que é completamente fundamental, porque nós temos que ter a capacidade de nos adaptar a qualquer situação. E como a Catarina ainda há pouco estava a dizer, se nós hoje temos um trabalho, amanhã poderemos ter outro. E este ano, ano de Covid, tem sido isso, ou seja, as empresas para sobreviverem têm-se reinventado. E nessa reinvenção nós temos que estar ao lado deles, ao lado da gestão de uma empresa, da administração, para conseguirmos que eles adaptem os processos e consigam manter o mesmo nível que estavam habituados. Outra área que nós temos e temos que ter todos, que é a área da engenharia, ou seja, eu considero isto, tudo aquilo que nós aprendemos desde as matemáticas, as químicas e as físicas, e aquelas cadeiras muito mais técnicas que põem-nos com a capacidade de pensar e de raciocinar e de ter lógica para conseguir encaixar nos processos todos. E por último, a inovação. Eu sou muito apologista da inovação e tenho a certeza que qualquer engenheiro que faça da sua bagagem uma boa bagagem e aproveite bem a academia por onde passa e todas as outras por onde pode passar, consegue inovar. Nem que seja uma coisinha pequenina, mas consegue sempre inovar. E isso faz a diferença numa empresa e faz a diferença no nosso planeta. Sendo assim, eu termino só com um desafio aos estudantes que nos estão a ouvir, que é: como é que gostarias que fosse a tua borboleta? E deixo um conselho, que é: aproveitem bem a era da universidade, a era de estarem a fazer o vosso curso, para aproveitarem todas as oportunidades que têm. É muito mais fácil quando estamos numa universidade chegarmos ao conhecimento do que depois quando estamos cá fora.
Fantástico, muito obrigada e muito sucesso para si. E assim terminamos a nossa parte do engenho. Esperamos que as experiências que trouxemos vos tenham inspirado, porque o mundo está em mudança e a engenharia do ambiente é, sem dúvida, uma profissão de futuro. Mais uma vez, obrigada e votos de um futuro brilhante em Portugal ou em qualquer outro local que escolham para a criação de valor sustentável.